Before we begin, I would like to tell you all that this session is being recorded and is also going live on our official Facebook page. Education is the passport to the future, for tomorrow belongs to those who prepare for it today. With this thought in mind, I, Parul Grover, Assistant Professor, DME Management School, and co-convener of this conference, extend a very warm welcome to you all to the inaugural ceremony of the Global Strategic Management Conference, GSMC 2020, organized by the Management School of Delhi Metropolitan Education. The theme of this conference is Remote Working Practices, Challenges, Opportunities, and Future Trends. The Zoom hosts for the day are Ms. Pooja Tripathi and Ms. Shanu Jain, Assistant Professor, DME Management School. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your support. Our culture guides us to have an auspicious beginning of any event, function, or occasion. Hence, we would start by a virtual lightning of lamp. For this, I would request the Zoom management team to kindly share their screen for the same. I would request the Zoom management team to kindly put on the volume as well. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. To give you a brief about our institute, Delhi Metropolitan Education, DME, is an A-grade premier educational institute affiliated to Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, GGSIPU, New Delhi. DME imparts education in the fields of law, management, and journalism, with the law courses covered by the Bar Council of India. The institute is located in the IT hub of NCR and is housed in a splendid building laced with modern education facilities, which is a necessity for enhancing students' creativity and capabilities. The sister institutes of DME includes Mayur School, Noida, in collaboration with Mayo College, Ajmer, Delhi World Public School, Greater Noida West, and Delhi Technical Campus, DTC, Greater Noida. To apprise you about the management school at DME, DME Management School offers Bachelor's of Business Administration BBA course, which is an intensive professional program. The endeavor is in the course is to sharpen managerial skills. The BBA course under GGSIPU has been designed in such a manner that it provides a strong foundation in learning business disciplines and enables students in key competencies, which are essential for business management at graduate level. At DME, we provide various opportunities for students to learn more about real-life situations in the business world. We organize expert lectures on management topics by eminent personalities from the corporate world. The course enables a student to acquire interdisciplinary knowledge of all the functional areas of business, as also obtain a practical working background for a facilitated entry into a management position. The Global Strategic Management Conference, GSMC 2020, by DME Management School, aims at discussing the upcoming trends of remote working in the wake of the COVID crisis. Let us see a small video which showcases what all GSMC 2020 holds. I would request the Zoom management to do the honors.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. We have with us today Ms. Gauri Das, Vice President and Head HR in Finance Solutions Private Limited, as our chief guest for the day. Ms. Gauri Das is a senior HR leader who is passionate about talent management and development. She possesses 14 years plus years of experience in all gamut of HR management and has been a part of diverse industries, example NBFC, financial services, and FMCG education industry, etc. Her strengths include strategic HR, building startup culture, developing high performance teams, HR business partnering, etc. She holds a double master's in HR management and psychology and a bachelor's in computer engineering. She is a certified rewards. She has certified rewards and NLP professional and also holds OD certification from Tata Institute of Social Sciences. She has been recognized as HR 100 under 40 and top HR Mind India and WICA Luminary Group. She believes in giving back to the society and is passionate about women empowerment and therefore founded a Lean In Circle called Leaders Lifting Leaders. Besides, she is also core committee member of LinkedIn local Navi Mumbai. She is currently working as Vice President and Head HR for India Factoring and Financial Solutions Private Limited, subsidiary of FIM Bank Group. We welcome you, ma'am. We also have with us today Ms. Ankurita Pathak, Joint Director, Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, Delhi, as our guest of honor. Ms. Ankurita Pathak is a working professional with 14 years experience in the domain of communications, content creation and management, stakeholder engagement, media relations, corporate social responsibility and print journalism. She is currently working as a joint director, FICCI. Ms. Ankurita started her career as a journalist. She has worked with Hindustan Times, Asian Age and the India Today Group prior to joining FICCI. She holds a master's degree in English from Delhi University and a diploma in print journalism. A travel enthusiast and a published writer, she has contributed over 80 articles, poems, travelogues, and short stories for the Assam Tribune, Northeast Times, The Sentinel, East Mojo, G+, Mystic Aura, World+, Inajari, Concerns and Voices, amongst others. In the recent times, she has written pertinent and well-timed articles about self-care, mental well-being, motivation, and coping up with the changing scenario. She loves food, fashion, people, and poetry. Welcome, ma'am. We are delighted to have you as our guest of honor today. We also have with us Mr. Aman Sahani, Vice Chairman, Delhi Metropolitan Education. Honorable Mr. Justice Bhavar Singh, sir, former judge of Allahabad High Court and now Director General Delhi Metropolitan Education. Professor Dr. Ravikant Swami, Director DME, also the advisor of the conference. Professor Dr. Purva Ranjan, Head DME Management School, also the advisor of the conference. Dr. Swati Jain, Head DME Outreach, also the advisor of the conference. We welcome you, sir and ma'am. We also have with us today esteemed faculty members from Sri Lanka, Professor Nagalingam and Dr. Acharya from Nepal. We welcome you, sir, and thank you for gracing today's occasion as well. I would now first like to invite Honorable Mr. Justice Bhavar Singh, sir, former judge of Allahabad High Court and Director General DME, to shower his blessings on all of us for the conference. Sir, you are on mute. The Zoom management team is requested to make DG sir the co-host.
Okay. Yes. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
The chief guest, the guest of honor, Mr. Aman Sahani, the vice chairman. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to participate this conference on a very important topic, remote working practice I would like to say that remote working practice is not a thing of only COVID times or of last few decades, but for hundreds of years, combining workplace and living place has been a natural way for families and communities. I remember the stories of hunter-gatherers who stayed in jungles for sustenance and brought the fruits of labor back to the hearth. They hunted animals and consumed them with their families. Also, they sorted and ground grains and fashioned clothing for coverage and protection. Friends, in the medieval times, the working classes set up craft and trade, focused shops in their dwelling houses. They offered goods and services to support their families in living spaces, which were architecturally designed to accommodate work from home. During medieval times, most working class, particularly the English people, lived in work homes, that is single story one room houses, which were combination of kitchen, spinning, dressmaking, workshop, bedroom, dairy, and dining room. Boundaries between home and work life were blurred at best. Earlier, at home, work in Middle Ages covered professions like bakers, shoemakers, potters, weavers, and blacksmiths. And gender gap was not a significant factor, as male and female members of the family were the contributory factors. Even schools were opened by tutors in their homes. The all hands on deck spirits of working from home place some values on many skills at which women largely excelled in sewing, stitching, calligraphy, or womanly art. The Renaissance focus on administration led to offices separating living areas from shops, labs, or workshops facing the main roads. In 1581, Uffizi Gallery in Florence was built, and in the administration, archives, and a state court came together to work in the same building. It was the same Florence, friends, as you might be knowing, where Florence Nightingale, the best nurse in the world, was born. The Industrial Revolution in medieval times pulled the workers from homes. Factory work, particularly in the textile industry, for women leaving homes and toiling in outside work environments. The means of production were transferred from the work home to the work site. Despite the advent of work opportunities outside home, some people continued to work for pay from their homes into the 19th and 20th centuries. For women, that work may have included doing laundry for outsiders, providing foods and bagged goods to sell the factory workers, or doing finish work for shoe and garment manufacturers. Down the 20th century, modern offices came into being. Office work brought further change. First, commercial spaces were hugely transformative. The telephones, the telegraph, public electricity, the typewriter were some of the precursors to the remote office communication tools we use today. Public transportation options that enabled workers to commute to and from workplaces had a huge impact. Women in particular moved into a new realm of professionalism that took them beyond their domestic skills. The job of secretary is still a leading position among so-called pink collar workers, require trading outside their homes for the office. World War II, ladies and gentlemen, changed the definition of women's work. To this day, working from home is often thought of a woman dominated, even though equal number of men and women engage in remote work. The female flock of the males who had gone to participate in the World War needed to work in factories and shipyards. Women left home to enter the workforce by millions world over. The number rose from 11 million to 20 million. Although after the Second World War was over, large number of these women returned homes to their traditional roles. They had succeeded in changing the workplace forever. These wives of men going to battleground after the war focused jobs at home through multi-level marketing. Manufacturing and textiles were still booming. Industries up to 60s and 70s. But the knowledge economy that dominates today did not yet come into being. The artists, the writers continued to work from home. Now came with the beginning of 20th century, the telecommuting. A book was published by an American author, Jack Niles, with the title, The Telecommunications Transportation Trade-off. It was published in America. And the author suggested that either the jobs of workers be redesignated so that they can be self-contained, or their individual location or a sufficiently sophisticated telecommunication system must be developed to allow the information transfer to occur as efficiently as the workers were centrally co-located. Friends, today, telecommunications and information storage system have developed to a point where employees work from home as efficiently as to co-located centers. The gasoline crisis in late 70s and early 80s was solved by reducing the number of daily commuters to 10%. Also, suggestions came from different quarters and three features, namely services industry, declining manufacturing sector, and growth of information-based jobs, made it much easier for people to return to decentralized jobs. Home-based methods that were largely popular before the Industrial Revolution. Arguments and counter-arguments floated against telecommunication working, but a survey conducted in United States in 2016 set the controversy at naught. 43% of the workforce occasionally worked from home. Secondly, 100 top companies posted the most remote job listings. 2 out of 3 working women who were mothers too and work from home had to use supplemental daycare. This survey steamed up the remote working, and we traveled in this way to the COVID times, beginning in late 2019 and early 2020. Coronavirus forced us to stay homes, initially making us idle, but soon with working plans. As we were not used to this kind of working, we came across some problems and we found, but very soon we found ourselves on rail track. The debate is on when the terror and the effect of COVID-19 is over, we will again switch over to work out at the working places. But now the doors to work from home have been opened to avail of many benefits, which may include reduced commuting time, particularly in metro cities, lower personal costs of transportation, parking and food, improvement in the quality of work life and morale, a better balance between work and family demands. The services of urban company is the best example of huge advantages of working at home and out. I'm confident that some good results would come out of this conference. I wish it a great success. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. It is always a pleasure listening to you. Thank you so much. I would now invite Mr. Aman Sahani, Vice Chairman DME, to apprise the guests about the Institute and express his views on the theme of the conference. I would request the Zoom management team to kindly make Aman sir also the Okay,
please. It's wonderful to be here. Good morning to everybody. It's wonderful to be here out of this conference on a very, very important topic, something that all of us are still exploring. But first, a bit about the Institute. I think a lot has already been said, and we have three courses, three departments, three schools. Essentially, one is management, one is journalism, and one is law. And all three of them, I feel, are quite competent and doing quite well. And as a regular part of our academic calendar and proceedings, we have a large number of events, lectures, and conferences. And we're trying to expand our conferences and make them international in nature and have a lot of involvement of all stakeholders, of writers, of academics, of researchers. So this is the conference that the management school is conducting this year. And like I said earlier, the topic is fascinating because it's still quite early days in this field for all of us to have been forced into exploring this idea of work from home. And I feel now that it's been perhaps about 7 or 8 months that a lot of people have been working at home. We are able to now get a truer picture of what are the positives and the negatives concerned with this idea. Earlier, I think in the first 2 or 3 months, for most of us, generally speaking, it was something very fresh to everybody. But now I think the results are seeping through and we're able to see more clearly if at all it is a good thing. Because I feel personally that contrary to what I think is a general optimism about the economy and the state of affairs right now, I feel that there are still millions of people who are impacted in a very negative way by this concept. And all of manual labor is something that obviously cannot afford something like this, a luxury of working from home. And but at the same time, we have to respect the human element of the difficulty that people are facing and offer people a way out in case they're not able to come to work. So I think it is really interesting to study how this is something that varies from industry to industry, from job profile to job profile, from country to country, perhaps culture to culture. So I think at this point where we feel that a vaccine is around the corner and we're entering the home stretch, it is really interesting to see how this concept of work from home has worked out for different parts of the society, for different different companies, different organizations, different industries, and see maybe how we should proceed further as well with this idea. As with anything, especially these days we're observing with the COVID vaccines, it is at the end of the day, it is the research done that counts. It is not a layman's opinion that counts as much as proper scientific research. And that is what we seek to do out of conferences. So hopefully we'll learn some good numbers, facts, figures, statistics, opinions, studied opinions about the different aspects of working from home. It'll be really interesting to see. I wish everybody associated all the best. And I look forward to watching and learning more about this topic. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. I would now invite Professor Dr. Purva Ranjan, Head DME Management School and advisor to the conference, to set the theme of this conference.
Thank you, Parul ma'am. Warm greetings to Honorable DG sir, respected Aman sir, dear director sir, and valued guest for today, Ms. Gauri Das and Ms. Ankrita Pathak, and meticulous conference team and wonderful, delightful audiences that we have on this platform of GSMC that we have coined, Global Strategic Management Conference for the year 2020. Every year, Management School at DME conducts a conference on an exclusive theme, which is not only relevant, but also thought-provoking in itself. In the year 2019, we steered a conference on the theme of mergers and acquisitions. In February 2020, we conducted a conference on spiritual foundations of leadership and management. And now we are remote meeting for the theme of understanding the remote working practices, challenges, opportunities, and future trends. This conference is not only an effort to bridge the discussion gap between corporates and academia, but also an endeavor to bring academic fraternity members across the globe to have a cross-cultural discussion on the conference theme. The idea is to demystify the aspects of remote working practices within a holistic perspective of all the stakeholders involved. We will be having experience sharing, research sharing, and cross-cultural perspective sharing. During the two keynote sessions today, almost 8 to 9 masterclasses speakers across different countries, 40 papers presenters, and robust panel discussion on the last day, we will together unriddle the numerous questions that we have in our mind connected to the aspects of remote working. In the times to come, these deliberations and conference takeaways will help all the participants and the audiences to make better remote working policies in case they are in leadership roles or become a better remote worker as an employee. We will get a sneak peek into the future world of remote working jobs, required employability skill sets, and attitude to master to be a victor in the era of remote working practices. Today, with Ms. Gauri Das on this platform, I am looking forward hearing her discuss the HR perspectives and what type of leadership is needed to remote manage the workforce. The expectations of the employer from a remote worker in the current scenario is must to understand. We will deep dive into the world of work-life balance, self-care and motivation, and a good state of mind during the times of remote working culture with help of our guest speaker, Ms. Anukrita Pathak. My personal thanks to both the corporate leaders for accepting my invite and being available for today's deliberations. I hand over the platform to the host of today's session, Ms. Parul Grover. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the wonderful setting of the theme. I would now invite Professor Dr. Ravikant Swami, Director, Delhi Metropolitan Education, to present his views on the Indian academic perspective of remote working.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so that's the first natural question which has to be asked in all the platforms where we get to speak. So it's a great day today that we are opening a conference, and it's a great day because of many reasons. First reason obviously is the theme of the conference. Yes, it is a theme with which we have lived since the last, I'll say almost a year now, because all this started around February and now February is again going to come. Another reason why it is important is that this management school of DME, which was truly rated as the fourth evolving management school in the country. Yes, the school has evolved. It has evolved through the years. And one reason why this school was rated as evolving was that the conference themes selected were always very challenging. We never went for generic themes, and we always selected narrow themes, and we went for good quality research. So we were truly ranked by India Today as the fourth best evolving BBA in the country. Yes, today is an important day. And another reason why we are evolving is that this conference is different in terms of its texture also. Like a typical conference is 2 days, morning till evening, but then we thought that that would be very having a lot of fatigue in this kind of structure. So we made it like this, that it was spread through 7 days, and each day it was two and a half hours. So yes, this is a evolving management school. Well, I have to speak, I am into education since 1995, and therefore thanks to the conference conveners for giving me the theme suiting to me, a theme which is close to my heart. So I have to speak about how work from home has been working in specific in the education sector. I would put across my points in terms of the pros and cons, or the merits and demerits. Talking about the merits, yes, I will say that this work from home has brought in something called localization plus globalization, what in management terms we call glocalization. Yes, it's an example of glocalization with work from home in the education sector. And I can give you examples from my own college. Like here, I have teachers who are presently taking classes right from Ernakulam in the south to east of Kailash in Delhi, from Surat in the west to Sonipat right across Delhi, from Lucknow to Lajpat Nagar. The audience, I must tell you that presently I have teachers teaching from all these locations, to quote a few. And from the other side, the taught part. Yes, I have students who are at Madhubani in Bihar and also at Melbourne in Australia. Will you believe it? It is happening, I can tell you. One of my students went to Melbourne. He got caught there due to this COVID, but he is attending his classes and he is giving his exams, he is presenting, he is doing everything. So see the kind of globalization when we talk about education and work from home. It is possible all because of this. And we have students from UK to UK. The first UK is Uttarakhand, the second UK is United Kingdom. And we have students from Winnipeg in Canada to Wisconsin in USA. Yes, my dear audience, I can tell you, presently I have students who are at all these locations due to whatsoever reasons, but they are very well attending their classes and having an excellent attendance. Talking about the, so this was the first merit in terms of teacher and the taught when we talk about this work from home in the education sector. Well, another merit of this work from home is that self-monitoring is very much required. Of course, teaching is a profession wherein no one else can monitor you. When you are inside the class, no one can monitor you. But then with work from home, more of self-monitoring is required. So I was just thinking before speaking whether it should be a merit or demerit. Obviously, I am taking it as a merit. So self-monitoring is more required, and teachers are known for being self-monitored. So it's a great opportunity. Other advantages are generic in nature, like saving of time. My college time is over at 4:45, and I reach my home at 4:45 itself. So that's a generic kind of merit. And yes, talking at the country level, saving of fuel is a big merit as far as work from home is concerned, not restricted to the education sector. But yes, India is a fuel deficient country. Majority of our foreign exchange is going into the purchases of fuel. So with work from home coming up in a big way, I believe that our foreign exchanges will be saved, which can be used for other purposes. That's the purely economics point. Talking about the other side, the demerit side, yes, this work from home in the education sector has got a few demerits as well. The first demerit is the overlapping of the work culture with the home culture. If I am at home, you know, I can't claim that throughout the day for the entire duration of my college hours, I was working for the college. There is bound to be some overlapping, and that overlapping has to be handled. Say, for example, many of my teachers have got small kids. So I don't think that they can keep off their kids during the entire 7-hour duration. So those hindrances are obviously there. Like, we have been taught in management schools that there should be a dividing line between work culture and home culture. These two, like work culture and home culture, or professional and personal, are two watertight channels. But when we talk about work from home, these two watertight channels are no more watertight channels. Obviously, there is an overlapping, and the demerit is when there is an overlapping, then one loses the concentration. And obviously, as a teacher, I can tell you that for taking a lecture, you know, you need a lot of concentration. Teaching is nothing but storytelling. If I'm telling a story, I need to be focused. I need to have a rhythm. And if that rhythm is broken even by 2%, I can tell you that's a disadvantage when it comes to teaching from home. Second demerit, throughout my MBA, throughout in business communication, the famous authors, Bovey, Thill, Lessiker, what were we taught? We were taught to have an eye contact. Where is the eye contact in teaching from home? Obviously, we as teachers miss that eye contact. And I can tell you that eye contact is a key to communication, which is a demerit when it comes to teaching from home. If I'm teaching from home, you know, I can't ask people to keep their camera on, because if their camera is on, there are other disadvantages. So the eye contact is missing, and without eye contact, I can tell you, teaching, or talking in the general terms, the communication process is not complete. And if the communication process is not complete, the teaching delivery has got a hindrance. That's the second disadvantage or the demerit when we talk about work from home with specific reference to this teaching. Third demerit is the e-fatigue. I can see my teachers having a lot of fatigue. Well, teaching without eye contact, of course, it is sometimes irritant. Sometimes teachers feel frustrated also, because the kind of enjoyment which we were getting, my colleagues often tell me that, oh, we are not getting that enjoyment which we used to get in the class. And that enjoyment is a two-way kind of enjoyment. You know, the teacher enjoys while delivering, the teacher enjoys while communicating, and the student enjoys while grasping or absorbing. That enjoyment is missing while we are teaching through the online mode. And last but not the least, we have studied human being is a social animal. Without mixing with each other, without talking with each other, without gossiping with each other. Well, I think because, you know, while we teach, we talk, we gossip, we cut out jokes, you know, it's an entire storytelling. So with this human being is a social animal kind of thing lacking, I believe it's a disadvantage, it's a demerit when we talk about teaching. To conclude, I'll say that in a country like India, which is highly populated with a lot of population pressure, I believe that work from home can be very helpful, despite these disadvantages, can be very helpful in the teaching sector. And if this work from home is adopted in a big way, then Corona will be known as Krishna, which came and you know fought out the evils. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Very rightly said. We miss the students now while being with the students itself. So thank you so much for your address. Now, I would like to invite Ms. Gauri Das, Vice President and Head HR in Finance Solutions Private Limited, to express her views on the HR perspective of remote working.
Thank you so much, Parul. It was great listening to my fellow speakers talking about how work from home is not new and how it used to be a home office kind of scenario in earlier generation also, medieval era also. And similarly, it was great to hear from Mr. Swami that what's happening in academia at this point of time, what are the merits and demerits. And I really connect with this because it's very much similar to what's happening in corporates as well. So we have to, I will now share what's happening there exactly and what HR is doing in terms of that. Can you allow me to share my screen? Okay, I have the rights now. Can we start with our understanding of what can HR bring to table for an employee? Is it believing, is it becoming, belonging, or winning the marketplace? Can I hear some thoughts in the chat box, please? So what do we think? Is it belonging, becoming, believing, or winning the marketplace? A, B, C, D. What is our audience thinking on this? I think chat is allowed or it's not allowed, Parul?
Ma'am, chats with the hosts are allowed. But okay. I think if you are the co-host, then the students can message you specifically.
Okay. Okay, I'm not hearing from anyone. No worries. Maybe there's some challenge.
Hi, Gauri. I think for me, it's sense of belongingness. That okay. I belong to. For me, it's sense of belongingness.
Thanks.
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt in between, but your screen is not visible now.
Okay. Can you see it again?
Yes, ma'am. Now it's great.
Thanks. So it was, this is how the evolution has happened for HR. And today we talk about HR as winning in the marketplaces. So you definitely do people make, believe, become and belong. But what you are doing as HR is outside in today. It is all about winning the marketplaces so that your company can create an environment where people come to be a champion and they make you a champion. It is outside in today. So far, we used to think HR is responsible only for internal employees. But today, board is questioning you, investor is questioning you. You are going to client places and you are checking with them what kind of customer satisfaction you have. And then accordingly, you are changing your programs, you are training your people accordingly. So this is the new role of HR, and I'm sure Corona has accelerated this change. We were already a strategic partner. We were doing these things, but now HR gave a very much important role in terms of Corona. It is great to see that HR did a remarkable role when it came to COVID, and all the earlier things that were said about HR have changed today. So when it comes to designing any policies or anything related to employees, it's important to understand general business conditions for HR. Like I said, HR is now outside in. So what changed? We can see a lot of changes. These are the six things which change generally when it comes to any business. It can be social, technological, economic, political, environmental, and demographic. And mostly in this era, we are seeing COVID era, social and technological changes along with a lot of political interference and economic changes as well. When technology has come in, we have to change the way we were operating. Now, if you tell somebody, you write back to me on email, it becomes something outdated. It is all about tweets and Twitter these days. Similarly, social changes, the way we were interacting with each other has changed. People used to come together, hug each other. It's not going to happen for a very long time now. Economic, this crisis, as we all know, has impacted a lot. So now that we know there are these changes, how would you see this remote working? So some of these barriers, we already heard from earlier speakers, how it helped and how it challenged. So some of the barriers that we faced as an organization, it's like for employee, it's just a FaceTime culture. There is no one-to-one connect. There is excessive workload because there are two thoughts here. One is employee is thinking, I need to prove myself because there is a challenge in terms of job security. And manager is thinking, I don't see my person, whether he is working or not, I am not aware. So both of them, they are trying to balance it out and it leads to excessive workload. Manager are skeptical, like we discussed. Customer demands have changed. So earlier, in between, I would say in month of July, August, when business started, restarted, customers were not willing to let us in. And we are a non-bank. So we need customers' KYC and ticket size is very high. So we have to at least visit them and see whether they exist or not, because chances of fraud is also very high these days. So customers were not letting us in. They said, we will not allow you to come in. And if you want to do anything related to KYC, you do it online. That brought in this different change that now we are moving towards fintech. Fear of negative career consequences, no matter what you do, since it is not very much visible, you are not very clear whether your manager would be evaluating you well or not. And similarly, towards side of employer, there is concern about abuse of policies. So policies say that you have to be active for 8 hours, but we never deployed any technology to check out whether you were logging in or not, because we didn't see that this was a requirement. However, it may happen that it is abused. There have been instances in industry that people have started working for 2-3 employers. So they already started gig economy, which is not allowed when you are employed full time with someone. Reactions of customers and client, I discussed one example, difficulty in supervising employees. So some people who have this thought process, if the person is before me, I know what he or she is doing. No matter how much time they are spending on the screen, but at least there's that comfort that this person is doing something. Loss of productivity, yes, because moving from this mechanism to that took some time. So there was loss of productivity, but later on, it improved. Treating employees equally. This is another thing. So biases, all the biases that we have would come out. If I am a young mother, I would have that soft corner for somebody who is also similar. And likewise, other biases which will also come up in terms of work from home. So these are the current priorities which HR is trying to solve currently when it comes to remote working. First of all, the topmost priority is EX, employee experience. It is about that belonging, that purpose, that culture, that happiness. So each and every event, each and every policy, each and every instance count. Just like customer experience, when we enter a showroom or when we deal with a vendor, how do we take that experience? Similarly, this employee experience is critical. So though you are working remotely, you have to create that sense of belonging and purpose. You have to stick to your culture and allow and enable people to do that. Similarly, a component of employee experience, employee engagement, which is particularly related to what work they are doing and how they are achieving. So enablement was most critical in this scenario, that you enable them to work. All the tools, the infrastructure that is required to work from home. It included small things like tables and chairs and things like laptop, devices, data card, everything. That energy, because you are at home, you are not meeting people. So how do you connect? When we meet people, there is an energy in the room. When we go out and speak to somebody, that those water cooler comments or water cooler conversation, they bring in that everyday energy. Gossiping, it is also said from studies that it is a kind of energy which is transmitted when people gossip. And when they come back, they feel relaxed and fresh. That was not happening. So how do you do that? You bring in virtual mediums, you bring in technology to connect people. Empowerment is most critical. Like we heard earlier that in classroom, nobody can monitor you. And nobody similarly at the same time can tell whether it was good or not good, how you are doing it. So empowerment in corporate also is critical. And Corona created an environment where it was slowed down, wherever it was not available earlier. Because if for each and every decision you have to wait for hours, I might be working from 8 to 4. Somebody might be working from 4 to 11. And there are people even in my organization who were working from 11 to 7, 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. because they have young kids and those kids would not allow them to work. They'll spill something on the laptop. So they decided when kids are sleeping, they will be working. So if I started something and I was not empowered at 8 a.m. in the morning, I have to wait till 8 a.m. next morning because somebody else is going to start work at 11 p.m. So this is how the empowerment was provided. And people were encouraged to be self-motivated. We started a program which is called as My Motivator, because this was a time when people were not motivated themselves. So if you have somebody who is not only self-motivated, but is also motivating you, it is imperative that you bring in those qualities. And we are encouraging people on LinkedIn and other social media. So this is about employee engagement that HR is trying to achieve. Change management, a lot of things have been said about change management, that it was a movement from working at office, being there all the time, to using only technology. We have no eye contact here. There is nothing. So similarly, there is a lot of in terms of business change management. The policies have changed. Customers have changed. So it's time to survive, first of all. And then in 2021, you think about how do you come back? And in 2022, you think about thriving. So that kind of change management in terms of there may be some hits, there may be some decisions which would not be very popular. The leadership structure might change and those changes to be taken care of. Capability development, like I cited example of my organization, we are moving towards fintech now. It would have taken 4 or 5 more years, but now the change is inevitable and it's very close. So do I have people who will be able to work in terms of Internet of Things or AI or machine learning? We don't have the capability. So we need to have people. And similarly, when it comes to soft skill, the most important skill came out as resilience. Are we having resilient people? So when we are hiring now, the criteria is to check out how resilient you are. It's not about whether you would be able to do something, because every day things are changing. Something which I learned 2 years ago is of no use today. So resilience and both soft capabilities and in terms of technological capabilities, we have to work on it. Wellness came out as an excellent tool to connect with people and also need of the hour. Wellness is not only about mental health or physical health the way we used to think about it. It's also about financial support. It's also about community, because we feel happy when we are amongst the community. We are not today. So how do you support people to do that? Technology would do certain things, but maybe you can come up with a hybrid model where 2 days a week people operate from office and 3 days they are home. So both the things are balanced out. You have flexibility and you have that sense of community, sense of purpose as well. And similarly, the most important link today is managers. HR might plan something, but execution would always come through managers. So how do you empower managers? How do you train them so that they are able to pass on these things to their teams, so that they are not micromanaging, but enabling them? When it came to performance appraisal, the one that we did in June was not about achieving targets, because nobody could achieve targets. It's just 2 months. We follow Jan, December. So only Jan and Feb is what we got in terms of achieving targets, and rest of the months were just wiped out. So what do you converse? HR will guide you that it's not about achieving targets today, but it is about how did you cope with the situation? How is your pipeline being developed? Say, for example, if business was making 10 calls a week, now they are making around 100 calls a week because they don't have to move out. They are doing it on Zoom and it is possible. How motivated they are? Were they really encouraging each other? Was the main criteria when it came to performance management. And the most important thing is, when they came out of the discussion, were they motivated, or they were having even more challenges or more negative thoughts about themselves and the future of work? This was the most important criteria related to leadership development. And finally, back to work, like I said, hybrid model is what is going to happen, and it's going to save a lot of cost. But all these challenges are going to come, and it is going to be a new way when we are back to work. Now, these are some of the roles for HR in future. And it is important to discuss them because this will indicate what kind of changes are happening in overall working scenario. Well-being is an important aspect today, and similarly business behavior. So right now we are talking about HR analytics, but HR analytics will throw the data. We have pulse surveys today, so we come to know whether somebody is feeling good, bad, or they are happy, not happy, what happened on a particular instance that they are not feeling happy on a particular day. And then there are chatbots who will be having that first round of conversation with them. And believe me, chatbots are now favorites of employees. 30% of employees say that they will be reporting to a chatbot rather than a human being, because there are no biases. So when you have the data, you have to put it in use in terms of creating that well-being for employees so that they can give 100%. It's all about winning that marketplace. And that would be possible if employees are well. Human bias officer. We have heard the famous story of Amazon that the machine had biases against women, and that's how the applications were rejected. Now that we are fully relying on machines for at least first round of screening, we need to have someone who will teach machines that this is not right and there is a bias. Similarly, strategic HR business continuity. All of us know without people, there is no work now. It's all about technology and people who will be utilizing those technologies. So you need someone who will be working on these aspects so that business continuity is possible. We are immersion counselors. It's a time for VR, virtual reality. So when we are onboarding somebody, you are showing them the whole organization in terms of a virtual reality where they can get immersed and they can get the whole value out of it. But who would do that? So there will be one HR professional who would be doing it. HR data detective. We already have HR analysis, and it is going to only increase, because the quantum of data that we are receiving today has increased a lot. And we are having data pertaining to each and everything. Now you are driving a car, there is behavioral data which is getting captured. You are logging in, there is a data. Your face is giving some data. Pulse survey is giving some data. So there is a lot of data and inferences can be derived. And data machine can throw, they can analyze, but the right questions to be asked, it is to be done by human being. If you ask the right question, machine will give you right answer and you can take right decisions. Chatbot coach is similar to what we discussed, that there is first round of discussion with chatbot, and you need to teach that chatbot that if employee is asking this, this would be answer, and somebody would be doing it. And finally, head of business behavior. So since HR is collating a lot of data. From that data, business behavior can be inferred, and you can identify how the business behavior is currently and what is required for tomorrow. It's going to be machine and human being working together, and that's where in remote work and in future of work, these things would be coming from HR. Thank you so much. Over to you, Parul.
Thank you, ma'am. That was really informative and very interesting to know. I would now invite Ms. Ankurita Pathak, Joint Director, Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, Delhi, to express her views on the aspect of work-life balance during the remote working scenario.
Thank you, Parul, and good afternoon, everyone. Yes, it's 12:10, so good afternoon. And I'm truly humbled to be a part of this inaugural session of the GSMC 2020, organized by DME Management School. And here I must definitely acknowledge DME for providing such a pertinent platform to understand diverse viewpoints and global perspectives on remote working. And, you know, it was very interesting to listen to everyone. And especially I identify a lot with what Gauri said. And, you know, and Gauri, I follow all your LinkedIn posts and I completely resonate with all of them. And, you know, so it was interesting to hear your perspective and also from the academia and also the, you know, the part that Justice Bhavar Singh touched upon, you know. So here I am here to speak on a subject which is very close to my heart, and which is work-life balance during a remote working scenario. And it is a very vast topic, you know. So categorically to organize, it's very simple, but it is very difficult to categorically organize my thoughts. And so let me tell you at the very outset that I'm not here to preach on the subject per se, but just to share my experiences, especially in the context of the current times. So yes, when March 2020 came and suddenly we were all thrown off balance due to COVID, and this was something which we never heard of and or never anticipated, never expected. At that point of time, if someone told us that most businesses or most organizations would be running with employees working from home in 2020, I don't think we would have ever believed, you know. So before the pandemic, remote working was largely intentional. And people who chose it, and they knew that it would fit well into their lives, and they would maybe choose to work from home occasionally or maybe full time. So now when COVID happened, it was a completely different case. It was unplanned, it was unprecedented, and so setting up a perfect work from home scenario was not an option at that point of time. Suddenly you were told that you have to work from home. So that is the reason why we call it forced digitization also. So whether you like it or not, you had to adapt to it. Working from home became an inevitability, and virtual connect became the new normal. Suddenly we all of us found ourselves glued to our computers and life became digitalized. It was like a fast forward button to some futuristic world. So in my case, what happens is my husband, my 9-year-old and me in 3 different rooms and in front of 3 digital dabbas, you know, I call them boxes, digital boxes. We are all, since morning, we are all logged into that. And initially it was like a welcome break from our daily rush. You know, that morning you need to wake up, send the kid to school, get ready, reach office, and you know, that time management, working, and then coming back with that daily rush and then ending up your day in your evening chores. So initially we enjoyed that liberty of taking it a little bit slow and sleeping until late or some extra time here and there, no rush life. And this slowdown, it resulted in a lot of chaos, but also it resulted in a lot of new energy. And we were high on Josh. Suddenly cooking, baking, home decor, gardening and whatnot. I know I was personally very thrilled that, you know, this is the bliss that I had ever wanted. So new things began to happen. Cooking was not my forte. So, but without a help and without a cook, I started, you know, dishing out different food items. Sometimes they were delicacies and sometimes utter disasters. Okay, so there were several first in my case during the lockdown. I perhaps baked my first cake, made my first biryani. And, you know, there was this trend in between called Dalgona coffee. I don't know if you remember. So it was like a rage at that point of time. And gradually, we all got a hang of the new normal and kind of settled down. Then started a different story. And it started off with a different kind of frenzy, different kind of madness, and the working scenario completely changed. And this, I think, gradually it blurred the lines between our work life and our personal life. The digital integration so happened that we were, it somehow encouraged a culture of always being on, always being online, always being available. You know, whether you are expected or you are not, you are suddenly connected to all your devices and you are, you know, there was this, if you don't look at your emails or if you don't look at your system or if you don't look at your work schedules, maybe you think that you may miss out on something. And then with all the chaos happening around, it also dawned upon us that work-life balances become a little difficult, even so, more so less achievable than previously perhaps. And we were no longer in that 10 to 6 zone. Our daily timelines change, and sometimes it was like there was no timeline at all. Because as Gauri also mentioned, you know, those you had to empower people in different ways. You know, people were comfortable in different time zones. But again, you know, bringing them all together and, you know, working towards one particular objective or a particular project was difficult at point of time. So, and there was this difference, that difference between work and that home, all this, that thin lines, it got blurred. So the balance automatically also got blurred. So before getting into all this, you know, I would want to define what exactly is work-life balance. And we all know that it is the process of bringing equilibrium or stability to both work and life. But defining it in a technically correct way or in an objective way, I find it slightly difficult. So because it varies according to circumstances, and also it varies according to individuals. It is a choice of people. So before trying to, before coming to this session, I tried to read its exact definition. So that's when I came across this interesting history, and let me share it with you. It was the last stages of industrial revolution and people were basically overworked. In the UK, it was common for the average worker to work 14 hours a day, 6 days a week. So these long hours had social and health costs, especially for young children who were also working and also for women. So labor reformers, they drew an attention to this, and then finally UK agreed to fewer working hours for women and children. Around the same time in the US also, they started tracking the hours worked by the workers. And they discovered that on an average, the worker performed more than 100 hours a week, which was way too much. So October 24, 1940, after decades of worker movement, the U.S. officially, they amend Fair Labor Standards Act and adopt the 40-hour work week. So this is the first move in giving workers back more time. And the work and the term work-life balance first appears in UK in the 80s. As it was a plank in the women's liberation movement. So this movement advocated for flexible schedules and maternity leave for women. You know, historically speaking too, work-life balance has been a major issue for women. Though unlike in 80s, you know, now work-life balance is more targeted to be gender neutral and it should be attainable and equally distributed across genders. So I personally also, I don't want to bring gender into everything, but you know, social constructs are such, I'm sure you'll agree that, you know, gender divide somehow comes automatically to our roles that we play. As women, we have multiple roles. And also, I think we also have this thing, this syndrome called super woman syndrome. And we want to do everything. We want to be the best in what we do. So it's a constant struggle. You know, we are always on the edge, stressed, anxious, tired, giving our best here, there, and everywhere, you know. So I don't definitely mean that, you know, men, they do not have need to have work-life balance. Of course, all of us do. And, you know, now most men are also sharing the load of household chores. But my poor husband, he's been endlessly cleaning, you know, utensils if he can't cook. So, but as caregivers of the family, we have certain additional responsibilities. And I keep telling myself this, that there's a reason why we have perhaps 24 hours in a day, because we can easily divide it into three parts, 8, 8, and 8. 8 hours of work, 8 hours of sleep, and 8 hours of for life, for doing whatever you want. But how many of us actually can do that? You know, it is not possible to compartmentalize life into such watertight schedules. the problem is, again, you know, we want to do best in everything. We want to excel in professional life. We want to live healthy life. We want to eat well, sleep well, pursue our hobbies, travel, spend time with family and friends. Basically, we want everything of everything. And is it possible to have it all? So there where this, you know, this question itself, it leads towards stress. It is the first step towards stress. And with COVID-19, there are additional stress. You know, the numbers that you see, the surge in the cases and everything and whatever happening around you, the state of economy, you know, the state of migrant laborers and anything and everything, it adds to your personal stress as well. And at one point of time, you know, it happened so that I got tired of my josh and of cooking and all. And then I felt that kitchen is not the place I would go. There'll be strong force pulling me away from it. You know, that whole energy factor, it got reduced. In fact, my son also stopped asking me that, you know, what will you cook today? Because suddenly I might become emotional and I might burst into tears. Okay, I'll do jharu, pocha, khana, and then one mummy, and what all will I do? So there was no balance left at all. And it started taking a serious toll on our mental health as well. You know, not just mental health, it was our physical health that goes for a toss. Of course, they're interconnected. So let me share you my personal experience here. I was very positively and happily, you know, I completed 50 days of self-isolation, that lockdown period. And 51st day, you know, I was out of my door, landing straight in the hospital. And it was not due to COVID. It was due to acute lower back pain, you know, long sitting hours working from home, long standing hours working for the home. And even with a very strong endurance, I realized that I had hit a wall. And, you know, at that point of time, you have a lot of confusion in your mind, certain things that happens. You can't go to a doctor because you cannot expose your family to COVID risk, because hospital at that point of time was a scary proposition. And then now is the time when you cannot even ask your friends to come and help. So where will you keep your son? You know, what will happen to the house? And a lot of other questions that started creating a web of confusion. But, you know, certain things are way beyond our control. And pain also is one of them. So in that moments, I realized that everything could wait. You know, work could wait, household chores could wait. And what cannot wait is your own well-being, both mental and physical. See, here I would like to share two quotes by two powerful women. And why I would like to share both is because, you know, they resonate very strongly and are also very relevant in this context. And I couldn't leave any one of them. First one is by Michelle Obama. And she said that we need to do a better job of putting ourselves higher on our own to-do list. Okay. And then Hillary Clinton, she says, do not confuse having a career with having a life. And I am sure there'll be many who will not agree with this, but it is a matter of personal choice. Again, as I said, you know, some people, they enjoy being workaholics, frantically pursuing their professional lives. In fact, very recently, I happened to witness a long debate, you know, a prolonged debate on LinkedIn, where people were debating on this choice, you know, being addicted to work, pursuing career goals, and, you know, wanting to have a work-life balance. You know, my personal choice is I want to maintain that balance. Now, I want to give the best to both, to my professional life and to my personal life. And how do I do that? Firstly, I need to take care of myself. And if I am doing well, I can ensure that the world around me is doing well. And, you know, average person, and they spend almost 10 hours online. And we are constantly in the mental need to connect, to be connected to our devices, and so that we do not miss out on anything. This is especially true in the remote working scenario. Like, you know, I think Gauri mentioned about this, that water cooler discussions and all in the offices. Those are also a lot of occasions where we are relieved of our stress. Those are important part of our life. But here we are not connected to our people. You're not connected to your team. You're not connected to your office space. And that is the reason why I think that sometimes going to the office is important. And you're not physically present in your work environment. And you feel that there's some kind of a communication gap. And on the other hand, being online is also a kind of addiction that has been subconsciously cultivated. You know, it's like satisfying your mind, which is always information hungry. And it's like, you know, this term is called, I think, FOMO, F-O-M-O, which is like fear of missing out. We all, I think, have this in some way or the other. I don't know if you've watched this film called Social Dilemma on Netflix. And that's when I actually realized, and this I knew this fact, but that movie made me realize that we are actually puppets in the hands of technology. And like those voodoo dolls being controlled and manipulated, you know, to be hooked onto all those kind of apps. I'll not digress into that. You know, what I want to say is that it is important. Everything is important, you know. Finding that balance is also important, but it is not easier or as simple as we say. It is important to disconnect, and only if we disconnect, we can reconnect to ourselves and also to our priorities. I had recently written this article called Take Care of the Home First Before Impressing the Streets. And this was about why we should give importance to self-care. Dr. Purva Ranjan had read that article, and perhaps that's the reason why I'm here today. And I mentioned a dialogue from the movie Godfather. So this is a scene where Don Vito Corleone, he asks Johnny Fontaine, saying that Johnny is the son, he's the friend of his son, Sonny Corleone. So he says, Johnny, do you spend time with family? So Johnny says, sure I do. And then the Don says, yes, good, because a man who does not spend time with his family cannot be a real man. So in that context, he said that take care of the home before impressing the streets. So this statement, I identify with it profusely, not just in context of the importance of family, but in connection to my own self. You know, I believe that my first home is myself. And as I already said, that if I am at my best, I can give the best to my family, to my near ones, to the society, to my work, to everything else that matters. So it could sound a little selfish or self-indulgent to some people, but I think it is not. And I'm sorry, my laptop is getting discharged. Let me put it into charge. I'm sorry. So when we are all addicted to our mobiles. Without our mobiles, we are actually handicapped. So when you see your phone battery dying, what do you do first? You know, first thing that comes to your mind is, oh my God, I need to charge my phone. So this is the same with ourselves. Like those apps drain out the phone battery, we are also caught in that vortex of life, and it drains our life out of us in many ways. And COVID-19, if it has taught anybody anything, it is the importance of life. And life is not about our work responsibilities or our household chores. It is way beyond that. So it is important for us to set priorities, and only then we can, I think, attain some kind of a balance. And here I would say self-care is not a luxury or an indulgence. It is a priority. It is not just an emotional or aspirational need, but it is also adequately backed by scientific research. So I'll mention this book called Principles of Biomedical Ethics. And this book defines self-care as providing adequate attention to one's physical and psychological wellness. And, you know, more significantly, self-care is it's an integral part of the American Psychological Association's ethics code. You know, having said that, I don't think we need to get into any kind of pedagogy or philosophy or any kind of doctrine to understand that self-care is important. It is perhaps we deal with it every day and we struggle to our varied roles, and we know that it is important, but sometimes we fail to follow. It is so simple, but it could be a struggle. So our well-being is actually directly related to our productivity in both our professional and personal lives. And, you know, many a times it happens that we give in to unreasonable demands of our surroundings, and while trying to make every section happy, we lose a bit of ourselves. And that's where it affects both on our mind and the body. And our work also results in a lot of stress and burnout. Often it happens, you know. Especially working from home, I think it has added to our mental stress, because when we used to go out, that physical connect with people, you know, like meeting them, talking to them, discussing about varied things, we get breaks in between. In the house, it is difficult because if you don't work for your office, you have something else to do in the house. Okay, so it happens. So in my case, that everything is suddenly very good, and the next moment, suddenly it is overwhelming and unmanageable. I'm sure it happens with a lot of us, you know. And it's a natural phenomenon. It is something called occupational burnout. You know, WHO, it states that it is a syndrome resulting from chronic work-related stress with symptoms characterized by feeling of energy depletion or exhaustion, increased mental distance from one's job or feeling of negativism, and reduced professional efficacy. So study after studies, they've shown that work stress is actually a fact. It's not something which is created. And it is directly related to your self-care. The more we take care of ourselves, the less is the possibility to give in to such stress. That's where I think resilience is built. That's where I think a resilient person and resilient individual is born. It happens in your personal life. It happens in your professional life also. And there was this project called Energy Project, and they had done some research, and they found that workers who did not practice good self-care, they definitely had trouble in focusing on work, and they used to get easily distracted. Because, you know, they were not happy in their head, you know, they were not focused in the work. So, and this project's readings, it concluded that if you do not put your needs first, then ultimately you will not be able to perform well, or you will not be able to show up for others, as in you cannot show up for work properly. You cannot be consistently working. You cannot be happily working. So this is directly proportional to the me time that we allow ourselves. Our first responsibility is to ourselves. You need to take care of your body, you need to take care of your mind, and then they take care of you. So on an aircraft, when we first get in, they display all those how to put the seat belt and what to do in case of emergency, and they say that in case of loss of cabin pressure, please put on your oxygen mask first, and then you go on to assist other people. So if you are not alive, if you are not well, if you are not helping yourself, you cannot help others. And that is the reason why we can't burn ourselves out. We need to find that balance. And here I would say that achieving work-life balance finally depends on you. Being honest and sincere with yourself is as important to be honest and sincere in your work. And we get to choose. We get to choose our time and energy. They're precious, where to use it, how to invest it, and when to set the boundaries. You know, here, let me talk about this principle called Pareto's principle. It's an economist, Wilfredo Pareto. He says about this 80-20 rule. And this principle states that 80% of consequences come from the 20% of the causes. It asserts an unequal relationship between input and the output. And this principle, Pareto, he observed that 80% of land in Italy was owned by 20% of the population. That was in 1906. So here, these ratios are fluid. You know, I don't say that, you know, this is particularly static to our concept of work-life balance. I'm just saying that this concept of disproportion can be applied to such situations. For example, we can say that for professionals, 20% of our time spent working could produce 80% of the results. So working long hours actually do not equate to productivity. Quality of work is always about the above the quantity of the time that we spend on it. So according to this State of Remote Works Report 2020, it says that close to 98% respondents would like to work from home remotely. And therefore, it has now become an ethical imperative for organizations to provide an enabling and conducive environment. I think one of the slides in Gauri's presentation also mentioned that. And and it is responsibility of the organization also to encourage such a culture which focuses on productivity and output more than the time you put in. However, you know, there are times where employers might worry about the time theft and, you know, productivity losses and work from home periods. And there is also difficulty in tracking the time that the employees are putting in their work days. It could be difficult to maintain that kind of a level of trust towards employee. And I think it's a two-way street, you know. It's about building a culture of open communication, setting clear expectations, and focusing on being productive. And then there should be trust on both the sides. Regular feedbacks should be encouraged, and there should be flexibility. And I guess employees also need recognition, rewards, motivation, and employee well-being. And in HR perspective, I saw that all these were included. And you know, in return, as employees, everyone should be giving their best. It should be a win-win for both the sides. You know, as individual, this balance, however, could falter because of a lot of factors. But in my opinion, four things I think needs immediate focus besides our careers and finances. First one would be peace of mind. It's actually very important. Second one would be a healthy body and an active lifestyle. And I think we've got a little bit of extra time now, so we can focus on this. And some time which you need to spend with your loved ones, your family, your friends, you know, it is very important. And finally, that me time, which is important for you to reboot, recharge and reconnect. You know, I've spoken, I think, a lot, but to conclude, I would want to share a few of my own ways, you know, how I try to achieve work-life balance, especially in this remote working scenario. Now, I follow a time schedule. I log in and log off at my usual work hours, 10 to 6 p.m. It's not possible for everyone maybe to follow that time schedule, but I think following a time schedule, it is important. And I have a designated workspace. So that gives me an office kind of feeling, you know, and I try to avoid distractions as much as possible. You know, my son, that he's now a little grown up, so he manages many things by himself. So perhaps that's one point which is easy for me. But I think breaks are also important in between. So since you are at home, that difference is a little bit difficult, but a routine should be maintained. I plan my work schedule in advance. I have a to-do list and I will plan it in advance. I plan my household work also in advance, especially in weekdays. And I plan my after-work time also. Sometimes it becomes difficult, but it is important, I guess. So, and when there is bombardment of unscheduled work, I express my discomfort at times that this is not possible. But whenever it is required to stress everyone, we know our responsibilities and we do it well. And it might sound actually funny, but I dress up well and I sit for my work, you know, it gives me it's like a feel good factor for me. And it is important to know when to stop, when to disengage, when to disconnect. And the most common mistake that we do is we wake up and immediately we check in on our work emails. This is, in fact, we should not, morning hours, we should keep it for ourselves or our family or a little bit of time where you can relax and rewind and recharge yourself. And I also reward myself with occasional gifts. You know, I buy a new book for myself. I order a new plant for myself, some home decor item. And I take my weekends very seriously. Even if I don't do anything, even if I sleep, I enjoy my weekends, you know. So I spend time with my family, especially my son, you know, if not anything, we'll just lie down and he'll do his own stuff. I'll do my own stuff like that. And I pursue my passion. There should be something beyond your work life that you need to look up to. So here in my case, I love writing and I enjoy reading poems. I enjoy writing poems. So this is one thing I engage in. And often what I do is I change things in my house, you know, this location, this decor is not looking nice. I'll change something. So it gives you a different kind of a feeling. And I am learning a new language. I always wanted to learn a new language. I never got this time, you know, that I travel to some place and learn, and I never got this time. So I'm utilizing this time to do that. And good music, meditation works. You know, we should focus on maximizing the positive lifestyle benefits of working from home. And everything has two sides, no? You know, the yin and yang, you know, everything is all connected. So we should try and maximize the positive side and try and handle the negative sides well. And above yourself, I think we should love ourselves a lot. And taking care of ourselves should become a mandatory thing. And I think let us also accept that there's no defined or no perfect work-life balance. We can just customize it so that it suits us best. And, you know, my definition of work-life balance would be this. Yours could be different. And in fact, there's no set formula. But it is like a continuous process of learning, unlearning, and evolving. And last 8 months or so, I think we have all done this, learning, unlearning, and evolving, and sometimes settling, sometimes it's unsettling. And we should, you know, it's very clear in COVID-19 crisis that, you know, it will redefine what normal means in context of work. And so it is important to remain fluid, and we should adapt as we go and handle stress patiently, I guess. And at the same time, we should also constantly analyze and keep asking ourselves if we are at peace with our own self, our own work, our life, and what can we do to make it better professionally, personally. At the same time, we should respect our own surroundings. You know, we should respect our people around in our life, be it in work or in our personal spaces. So we should try and see and adapt and learn, and in the process, you know, do whatever best that suits us. And, you know, when times get difficult, let's just be kind to ourselves. I think this is the balance we can have, and this is the balance we need. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And I couldn't help but notice the beautiful palm in your background. And it has definitely added to the aesthetics of your...
Oh, my house is like a botanical garden now, you know. In the lockdown, I have collected all plants, and sometimes I actually talk to them, you know. It helps in managing your stress.
So you have green fingers then?
I do now. And remote working has helped me in that, you know. These are the things which I could probably never give much time to. Now I've got these things happening around.
Yes, definitely. So thank you so much, ma'am, for such an interesting and thought-provoking address, actually. We tend to forget ourselves, and I'm sure now we would lay more emphasis on home, which is us, basically.
Yeah, no, I think we should all watch that movie, Jab We Met, where, you know, Kareena Kapoor says, you know, main apni favorite hu, so we should all be our own favorite, you know.
Absolutely. So thank you so much, ma'am, for your time. Thank you. I would now invite Ms. Roli Wadhwa, convener GSMC 2020. To give a detailed view of this conference.
Thank you so much, Parul. Warm greetings to Honorable DG Sir, respected VC Sir, Director Sir, Purva Ma'am, esteemed guests, Ms. Gauri Das and Ms. Ankurita Pathak, and a wonderful audience. Before I give a detailed view of GSMC 2020, I would like to express my deepest gratitude to DME's management for giving me this opportunity to organize this mega event. I, along with the co-convener of this conference, Ms. Parul, have been planning this conference from the last 4 months. And I must say that it has been a truly remarkable learning experience for both of us. I hope this 8-day long conference achieves its objective of blending cross-cultural thoughts and experiences of academicians and participants. I would like to thank Ms. Pathak and Ms. Das for sharing their thoughts and letting us understand the corporate viewpoint on the theme. It was really a pleasure listening to both of you. In the upcoming days of the conference, we shall be having masterclasses from 7 international professors from different countries like Spain, Oman, Saudi Arabia, Nepal, Nigeria, Sri Lanka, and Belgium. The esteemed professors shall be sharing their perspectives on virtual working, linking it with the sub-themes of the conference. These masterclasses shall be followed by paper presentations on the sub-themes of the conference. On the final day, on the valedictory session, we shall be having a panel discussion wherein all the 8 international professors shall be present on a single platform and shall put forth their country's perspective on remote working. I really hope that through this global conference, the academic fraternity and our students are able to develop a holistic view of this new and transformational trend of virtual working. Looking forward to insightful and engaging discussions as a part of this global conference. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. Rightly elaborated. Now we all know what GSMC 2020 holds. With this, we come to an end of the inaugural ceremony of the Global Strategic Management Conference 2020. Well, they say that well begun is half done. With this thought, I extend a very hearty vote of thanks to Ms. Gauri Das and Ms. Ankurita Pathak for gracing this occasion and giving us the opportunity to hear a very interesting and informative address. I would also like to thank the leadership of our institute for taking some time out of their schedule and being a part of this inaugural ceremony. I hope and wish that the coming days of the conference turn out to be just as this ceremony. Thank you so much. Now, in your chat boxes, you will see a link that has been floated by Ms. Shanu Jain. This is the feedback cum attendance form for the students. Attendance form is for the students and feedback is for everyone present in the session. Do fill this form. We would like to know your valuable feedback for the session. Thank you so much. Please copy this link because in a few minutes we would be ending this meeting. Thank you. I would request the Zoom management team to kindly stop the recording now and also the